The panel that that I've been asked to moderate today is looking back, looking forward. So we'll be looking back and then looking forward. And what the format is based on a discussion model, a conversation. So I would like you to consider each and every one of yous as people as part of that conversation. So you will not have these formal presentations, but please know that before I introduce them, there'll be two rounds. The first round sounds like a debating club. The first round will be some general statements, introducing themselves, and then getting into the second round, I've asked my panelists to consider three questions, of which we'll be putting on the big screens for you at that time. So once again, consider yourselves as part of this discussion, and feel free to put up your hand and then offer comments, questions, and let's enhance this this conversation that we're going to have. So this will be about till noon, so sit back and hold on to your seats. So in that regard, I'd like to introduce our panelists for today. Our first panelist is going to be Ms. Geneviève Dubois-Flynn. Geneviève has a degree in law and has received her PhD in philosophy from Laval University in Quebec. She is currently the CIHR, the Canadian Institute of Health Research, advisor on Indigenous research ethics. She was closely involved in its development, promotion, evaluation, and implementation of the guidelines for health research involving Aboriginal peoples. She was also a member of the University of Ottawa Research Ethics Board for Health and Health Sciences, vice chair of Healthbridge Research Ethics Board, but as well, as you know already, an organizing member of CUREP. Then we'll have Mr. Gilbert Whiteduck. He was elected chief of his community for many years, but he holds a Bachelor of Social Work, Bachelor of Education, and Master's in Education, and honorary doctorate from the University of Ottawa in 1999. So he brings over 33 years experience at the community level, and is presently the counselor in a First Nations treatment center. But he's also a friend of the Institute, and I look forward to hearing him again this year. Mr. Tony Belcourt, his career spans 45 years of experience and has significant achievements in Aboriginal affairs, corporate governance, government, and not-for-profit sectors. Instrumental, Mr. Belcourt has been in helping to found, lead, and serve various boards regionally, nationally, and internationally in various Aboriginal organizations. He's also a Métis Nation ambassador for international issues. He's worked on meetings that work towards Indigenous self-determination, but as well in the United Nations Organization of American States, helping to craft language on the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. He's served on many boards and advisory committees. He's currently the Director of Canadians for a New Partnership. In 2006, he received a National Aboriginal Achievement Award for public service. And he's also received an honorary doctorate in law from Lakehead University in 2010. And Mr. Belcourt in 2013 was appointed an officer of the Order of Canada. Scot Nickels has been working with Inuit Taparit Kanatami for quite a number of years. Him and I were colleagues when I worked there as well, and I'm very pleased to see him here. He's the director, as the director of the Department of Environment, and then years on, he became ITK's senior science advisor, responsible for advising the executive and staff on research and science-related issues. And in 2010, expanded his science advising role to become the director of Inuit Khawisavingat, the research center at ITK. Scott holds a PhD from the Department of Geography at McGill. He's authored several peer-reviewed articles, given numerous presentations, and he's a great friend of Inuit, and very glad to see him here today. We thought it was important to be grounded in some of the historical and contemporary issues across this country. And because of the program this week, you'll get into very potentially specific areas. But I alluded to one word a few minutes ago, self-determination, because it has some critical aspects. We think of research in communities as potentially separate from other issues. But I think you'll see an important tie-in between self-determination, communities, reciprocity, relationships. That'll add more food for thought. I want to give Geneviève the first round, first few minutes. So Geneviève, without further ado.
I would like to start acknowledging the unceded and unsurrendered Algonquin territory. So I'm here to represent the CIHR community. The Canadian Institutes of Health Research is a major funder, public funder of health research in Canada. And its mandate is the creation of knowledge. So it funds research in a number of ways. It has very specific programs. We can talk about that later if you're interested. And the other part of its mandate is the translation of that knowledge into improved health. It has the two aspects. And CIHR also has an ethics mandate, which is actually quite unique for a funding agency to have it entrenched in its legislation. And what does it mean? It means that actually CIHR funds research to explore discussions of ethical issues that need attention. And CIHR, looking back, was created actually in the year 2000. So some of you may know that it came after the Medical Research Council, but was there before, and that actually had a much narrower mandate, as its title indicate, much more focused on medical rather than health, that CIHR's vision tried to encompass. And why CIHR model is so interesting is that it's actually the result of a bold vision to create an organization with 13 virtual institutes. Each of these institutes led by an expert in his or her field in science from BC to Newfoundland. So these scientific directors are all around based on their area of expertise. And CIHR has an institute on Aboriginal people's health. And the mandate of the Institute of Aboriginal People's Health is to, of course, fund research to try to improve health outcomes of Aboriginal communities. So this is the focus on population. There are also other institutes that focus on specific populations, like the Institute of Human Development, Child and Youth Health, the Institute of Aging. But what we are interested in is the Institute of Aboriginal People's Health. And the Institute has been playing a very important role regarding the way research is framed regarding ethics. Because its leader, scientific lead, Jeff Redding, played a very important role. I actually remember a plea that Jeff Redding, the scientific director, the original scientific director of CIHR, made to his 12 counterparts. I said there are 13 scientific directors. A plea that he made to the other scientific directors and to the CIHR president, saying, so I have a funding envelope. How am I supposed to fund research for my people, my communities, if I don't have an ethics framework, if I don't make sure, ensure that the research conducted with my people is ethical? So he was saying, I am in an untenable position. How do I do that? So I'll I'll continue afterwards because we take one question at a time, correct? We'll have six rounds. I want to make sure. So I'll tell you what his plea was about and what it resulted in.
I'm here with a lot of sadness. Over the weekend, a young Anishinaabe man, 18 years old, was tragically died. A lot of speculation, but it's one of those things that continue to unfortunately occur in our communities. And what is always so interesting is that tons of research has been done, loads of recommendations have been made. And as I now tell people, all I'm seeing, and I can only speak for myself, from my experience, all I'm seeing is that either people saying how sad they are, that they're unable to do anything, and I see a lot of people hugging each other, which is all nice. Hugs are fine, but no clear action that are going to come and help our young people in particular, all of our people, but our young people who are in every community. No community is spared. No community in Canada is spared, unfortunately. And I could go on into many pieces of that, but suffice it to say that the disconnect from land, the disconnect from language, the disconnect from identity has played such an impact. And that's colonialism and all that it's done. But what do we do about it? But I'll leave it at that. I've had the opportunity in my community to have worked over three decades in education, and then was elected as chief in a community, and I played a number of roles, and now I'm working in a treatment center, a residential treatment center, and I will be taking on the role of a clinical supervisor in the coming months, and I have to acknowledge, really, Carleton University and the Bachelor of Social Work degree that I got from here that allowed me to really pull together those pieces that allow me to do the work that I'm doing. So that's a real positive. But when I look, having been in the community all of my life, in all of the different positions, I've grown so skeptical about research, about people who come in. And I can look back, when I do research, I look back to the 20s when the anthropologists came into our community and literally lied to the people. They mined our culture. They came, there was mining going on. They were digging all over to appropriate themselves of who we were, our identity. And then to come and to interpret it within the museums, within research papers, or even worse, they acquire their PhDs at the university and then become our voices. And then become our voices. We have a voice. We're capable of speaking and articulating those things. It's not to say that we're not seeking for allies. We need allies. As we say, when the War of 1812, when the British were looking for allies, we allied ourselves along with the British. We now need Canadians to ally themselves with us, not to do it for us, but to do it along with us. So I've had many difficult situations of individuals, again, university types, let alone government people coming in and gathering information, not respecting protocol in a community, not respecting adults and not respecting elders. Assuming that what they had learned maybe in university was the thing to do. So it was no longer a natural protocol. And because of time frame, I've got to do it here, I've got to have this paper in, you know, my contractor is asking me to have these deliverables. Forget the reality of what goes on in the community. And therefore, for me, a very fundamental concept of ethics, and that is respect. And respect means you learn first and foremost. Don't be in a hurry. Learn first and foremost. What are those protocols? And give yourself time when you're doing it. And for me, any research in regards to Indigenous people needs to have practical application for Indigenous people. It's got to have a meaning for us. Otherwise, what the heck does it mean? And that's been, I think, the challenge we continue to have. Although there's a little bit of like the stars in the sky, we see some sparkles here and there where people are attempting to do that. But I don't believe that in 2016 things have gone far enough. I'm always very disappointed when I speak to other First Nations, Anishinaabe First Nations up north, who are sometimes less equipped to deal with people that are coming into the communities. Whether it's research about territory, environment, whether it's research about social issues in the community, you know, and again, we'll talk about it later, but an example of somebody coming in and saying, well, we have this beautiful project, we got $500,000, we got a year to do it, are you okay with it? We figured it out, you're gonna fit in, we'll hire one of your people to go door to door, sign here, sign your consent, you know, and if you don't, oh my gosh, you're gonna lose it, you're gonna lose all this valuable data. Unacceptable, unacceptable. So the whole thinking about how the relationship between researchers and Indigenous people, yes, there has to be a framework, but the framework cannot be developed outside the community. It's got to be developed with the community. The protocols have to be understood with the community, and there has to be respect that guides everything. And we need to even define, what does respect mean? Does respect mean that you're just going to inform me? Or does respect mean you fully involve me in all aspects of what's going to go on? So I'm sure we'll have the opportunity and look forward to questions and the exchange, because I think that's where the richness lies. So, any questions?
In 1985, I was gifted with the name Wickley. Gosh, my mind. Somebody was saying he was born in the 50s. Well, I was in the 40s. Wolfwalker by an elder, Rufus Goodstriker. My home community is Manitouk Sayhin. Which in our language means Spirit Lake. It's been called Lac Saint Anne. There was a vision of Saint Anne on the lake in 1850 by a priest, and he called it that and set up a mission. And the mission grounds and all other territory around that is where our community comes from. I came to Ottawa in 1971. I was, prior to that, vice president of the Métis Association of Alberta. And Métis leaders in the West decided that we had no chance of addressing or getting any anybody to pay attention to our claims, our land claims, the fact that our lands had been taken away. We're the Indigenous peoples in North America that are completely landless, except for some land set aside by the government of Alberta in Alberta. So we set up that organization, and I was named the president of that organization called Native Council of Canada, and we got together with non-status Indians at the time because we both wanted to have a national voice, first of all for recognition and to be able to address our issues. In those days, Indian women would lose their status if they married anybody who was not an Indian under the Indian Act. It could have been an Indian person or a First Nations person, but if they weren't on the Indian registry, they would lose their status. And so did their children and so on. So we got together and came to Ottawa. And I already knew and had experienced racism, which is learned behavior based on a lot of attitudes that are developed by people over time and a lot of misconceptions, sometimes fears. When I came to Ottawa, it certainly it magnified for me how little people knew about the Métis and the kind of confusion that exists about the Métis. And unfortunately, that is perpetuated today. We are constantly being defined by others in different ways. One of the things I wanted to point out is that I had not heard about ethics and research of Indigenous peoples until I was invited to participate in this panel, and I didn't quite understand why I was being asked in the first place, since I'm not a researcher. My last stint in active politics was as president of the Métis Nation of Ontario for 15 years, from 93 to 2008. And in between that time, I was involved with the Métis National Council and so on. So I participated in research. We've done our own and so on. And we've had other people do research and come to see us. Never heard about this, the ethics and research standards that had been established. And then I never heard about Chapter 9. And in this prep meeting, I'm thankful very much for that, Catherine, for that preparatory meeting, because it really helped me to understand a number of things about, first of all, what was going on in this whole world of ethics and research. And I learned about Chapter 9. I said, what's Chapter 9? Because John Kelly was talking about Chapter 9. And so he was kind enough to send me the link to Chapter 9. And I discovered that I've got some issues here with Chapter 9, which I think go to the root of why there's so many misconceptions about the Métis people. When you start off with a definition that says Aboriginal peoples includes persons of Indian, Inuit, or Métis descent, regardless of where they reside and whether or not their names appear on an official register. Well, the word peoples is a very significant word in international law. That's why the declaration is called the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Peoples are a people. They aren't individuals. Individuals are members of peoples. First Nations peoples, the Inuit people. The Inuit are a people. So are the Métis. So when we, this is something that I think is really a fundamental issue that needs to be looked at. A lot of people claim Indian ancestry and say, I'm Métis. Well, that's fine. There's another part of this definition that I think needs to be augmented as well. It's called self-identification is a fundamental criterion for defining Indigenous peoples. Yes, but so too is community acceptance. The two go hand in hand. So in the Métis Nation, for example, we have a Métis Nation registry. Now that's an interim policy or an interim registry because we haven't had the funds to implement the community acceptance process. So we ourselves within the Métis Nation are still evolving and developing our own registries. But something is very clear. Nobody can say I am a Métis person from the community of Lac Saint-Anne. They can say that if they want. But if they aren't accepted by that community because nobody knows them, ever heard of them, and so on, then how can they be considered to be part of that community? Now, I do acknowledge and understand very well, and I've experienced this as growing up, that a lot of people have been disconnected from their communities because they've been adopted out or moved away for all kinds of various reasons. And so a generation or two later, some people come back and they say, hey, listen, I'm proud of my heritage. I'm proud of my ancestors who are from this community. Well, it's up to the community to say, yeah, okay, you are part of this community and be able to participate in all of the things that the community will enjoy, whether it be rights or special programs or services that the community has developed. So community acceptance is is a critical aspect of defining the people and the community. That's another issue. What is the community? So there are communities of people with vested interest. These are associations for various reasons. Someone mentioned friendship centers. They have an incredibly important role to play. Various other kinds of organizations that come along. But in terms of dealing with a people, there can only be the people who have come together as a collective, who share common history, tradition, culture, language, territory, and have formed their own representative organizations or governments or governance structures. So the right of self-determination means that we can we define who we are. Yes, that's true. But there must also be community acceptance. And I wanted to point these two things out in terms of this. I have other things to say about this, by the way, but I'm just starting to get into it, and I don't have much time now anyway. But I do intend to actually follow up, because these things concern me, because they do lead to further misconceptions and misunderstandings about who the Métis people are. That's all I'm going to talk about, who the Métis people are.
Hi, I'm Scot Nickels. I'm really honored to be with such a distinguished panel and to be asked to speak with you today. I'll recognize being on unceded Algonquin territory, and had the great fortune to work with the Algonquins of Barrier Lake, just north of Kitigan-Zibi, there for many years ago. And but today I'll speak to you on behalf of my president, Natan Obed, who's president of Inuit Tipitit Kanatami, the national organization that represent the Inuit of Canada. And he's asked me to come because I had some involvement in reviewing the Tri-Council Policy Statement number 2 back in the day, and have continued on working on research issues since then. Natan is elected by the presidents of the four land claim organizations that span across the Canadian Arctic, from the East Nunatsiavut, Southern Quebec, Nunavik, Nunavut, and to the furthest west, the Inuvialuit. And the presidents of those land claim organizations are elected by their population within their region. And in this way, Inuit have a Canadian Inuit democracy, and with constitutionally protected rights and agreements with the Crown in terms of how one deals with the environment, wildlife, and those sorts of things. And given that relationship, and talking here, we're talking about the past and looking into the future. In the Arctic, in the past, there was a number of visitors, and some of the Inuit history is very similar to other Indigenous peoples throughout Canada. You know, originally we Inuit had the whalers that were that came up to harvest whales and send the oil back to Europe. You all know about the Hudson's Bay Company and fur, the fur industry. Certainly the missionaries came to spread the word of God. After the Second World War, we Inuit had the governments move in and establishment of the distant early warning sites, the dew lines that were spread across the north that established some military installations, and and the mounted police that came up. Anyway, a whole myriad of individuals that came up and institutions that came up to make a living and to get something for themselves from the Arctic. And I think Pitseolak identified early in his talk that research has been one of the most recent, I suppose, that over the last number of years, it's been very evident that research has also been part of the colonialist enterprise, and the equality in research has not always been there, and we have still a ways to go. I think we have the Tri-Council Policy Statement. We have the CIHR originally, which actually had an Aboriginal section before the new Tri-Council Policy Statement, Chapter 9. We have the UN Rights of Indigenous Peoples. We have institutions in the Arctic that require research license agreements to be signed and approved before research is conducted. What else do we have? We have the Truth and Reconciliation, the 94 Calls for Action, which also provides some guidance in moving forward. And we have an improving Inuit to Crown relationship with this the new current federal government. So on paper, it would appear that Inuit have some pretty good tools to be dealing with research and research ethics and with the general populace and moving forward how things should be conducted in the Arctic. But I think Inuit have found that there's still this very unequal relationship. And Inuit are moving forward, very much interested in moving forward the yardsticks on self-determination in research. And of course, research ethics is such an important part of that self-determination in research. And I think I'll just leave it there as setting the scene and have more to say about more of the present situation and then where we might go in the future. But just thought I would bring that forward as an introduction.
Thank you so much. I've asked the panelists to consider several questions because I think it's an opportunity to set some deeper context, because the subject matter that you'll be exploring this week will be an eventual draft submission to a model of research ethics board, but context is really important. You're getting a sense of kind of the unique historical perspectives of each of these folks whose communities they've been working with for quite a long time, and I think you're starting to get a sense of what some of those issues are around, in particular, working with communities that have their own needs and priorities. And because of that, I've asked them to consider, and I will ask you now to consider these questions. And I think they're very relevant because you'll be getting into the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples. You'll be hearing a wonderful lecture this week. You've heard that the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. So there are these documents and tools that we work with that help you, navigate as you move forward. But I think the bigger context around it, and the word that often isn't used in research, is people's right to self-determination. So I thought it'd be important to kind of add some of that context. So I would ask the participants, and I would ask yourselves, to consider these questions and just offer your own perhaps questions to the panel or with each other. But I wanted to use these as a guide, and feel free to interject or add. So I wanted to ask the participants, the first question is, regarding the past, why did your community, and community could be the organization or the community that you've been working with, so why did your community become concerned about research? Geneviève?
I don't know how much you know about the past history and past abuses, but I think, of course, it needs to be said we can't continue the discussion without referring to these cases, and I'll only be mentioning a couple of them. So there is the Nunchanul case, the tribes in British Columbia. This is Canada. This is not the U.S. or someplace else. This is Canada. And the community, and I want to apologize, first of all, to panel members if I use terms that make you, please tell me afterwards. So I apologize in advance because I realize you will hear a few of those, but I'm trying my best. Okay, so the Nunchanul case is the tribe that was in BC, and they had many problems with arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, and the tribes and the people were very much affected by that condition, health condition, and I don't know how it happened that anyway, either a researcher was aware or. Anyway, so a researcher came into their communities and offered to do research with them, or on them. And he said that maybe he would be able to find a cure based on, the research that he'd be doing with them, and for instance, withdrawing blood samples from them, and then try to find something. So of course, the community was extremely enthusiastic at the idea of having research conducted, and maybe, why not? The hope of finding a cure for their communities that were in such, that were suffering so much from that condition. So Richard Ward came and took many blood samples from these communities, asked for their consent. So the idea, of course, that he would be focusing on the issue of arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis. Well, as it turns out, that researcher and his team had a number of other interests as well. One of them was genetics, anthropology. So he never mentioned anything, of course, to the communities. And through the years, actually, he got to use these blood samples for purposes other than what he had obtained consent from them. And not only did he use them in Canada, but he used them in the US, even in Oxford, in England. So these blood samples have been traveling extensively, of course, without the communities knowing about this. And whether the researcher actually found anything that could help these communities, actually, he had to admit that actually he was not able to find any particular results that would actually help to alleviate the conditions of these communities. So this is an example, and the Nunchanul were extremely disappointed, this is a very minor term, when they heard about what had been going on with their blood samples and the meaning that you, of course, again, better situated than I am to explain this. That blood samples are not just a component of a body, but they are part of the whole person. And actually, it's in a way, it's there's a good ending because the blood samples were returned to the community many years later. And the community was able to give the attention, the respect to these component biological samples. Human parts in the way that it deserved. And actually the researcher passed away, and anyway, so That's very unfortunate. There is another, there was another case in the US at the time of Havasupai tribes where something quite similar had taken place, but these are just one of many, many examples. And actually at the Canadian Association of Research Ethics Boards that I attended in 2013, a researcher brought up something that hadn't been really circulating in ethics research discussions until then. And it had to do with, yes, First Nation, Métis and Inuit people. And it had to do with the experiments that took place in residential schools and what is now known as the residential schools nutrition experiments. We know that many things went on. Well, also that went on within these schools. And stating the plain facts, yeah, Aboriginal students, peoples, were being used, children were being used to study, for instance, tooth decay. And whether these children were in pain or not in pain, they were used and researchers wanted to see how far, you know, the tooth decay could go without treating the children who they knew were in a lot of pain. So that's another case that came up that was put to light, fortunately, recently. But again, I mean, yeah, it leaves us speechless to us, white people. And we know that this went as well on with prisoners in the US and black people. And so, so why Jeff Redding wanted to make sure that there were proper safeguards in place regarding ethics. I mean, he maybe didn't know about the nutrition experiments, but I mean, he knew about a number of other cases. He had heard directly from his communities as well. So that's why he wanted to make sure that there would be guidelines. That's the least he could do was to ensure that guidelines would be in place. I'll stop here.
I'm very proud of the community that I live in. And I'm not only speaking about what's called the Indian Reserve, but on the fact that we're on the territory, as was mentioned this morning, how important that is, that connection. But our community has always been really concerned about research. When I did a bit of my own research internally to see what had been happening since the formation of our reserve, the government at the time, on August 9th, 1853, pre-Confederation Reserve is what we are, people were concerned, but were not in the position of power to do anything. And we could see that a lot of data was being collected that was going to be used or attempted to be used against us to try to demonstrate that the assimilation process was working. But I just want to share with you three or four situations of the past that, I mean, it really leaves much more than a sour taste in our mouth, but we become so skeptical, and it's hard to break free and to find trust in people beyond that. And I spoke earlier about the anthropologist who had come in the 20s to gather information about our territory, our ceremonies, our cultural objects and whatnot, and went on to interpret them in writing. And those have been used by government departments in those early years. But I also recall in our community, and I don't have the exact date, but maybe in the late 80s, early 90s, where the University of Montreal came in. And they had come in to do research in regards to what they call diabetes. So they had a whole team of people. Flyer went out in the community. We were invited to come in to sign a paper. And they were going to take blood samples, and a number of other tests were done. Everybody said, well, it appears we do have a problem with diabetes. It might be good to kind of do prevention, find out, and all of that to say that in the end, I mean, they did all of this over several weeks, gathered all of this data, all of these so-called experts. Then we didn't hear anything. And then we got a paper saying, here's your lipid count, and it kind of listed it all out where we were individually. But only to find out years later that they had totally screwed up and they had contaminated many samples. And therefore, all of this research was for nothing. But nobody came back to explain. Nobody came back to say, here's why. And you know, we're giving you back the blood samples. Where did those go? Who knows? Who the heck knows? Nobody does. And that's the kind of thing, you know, when you, that occurs to you, that you say, not again, we're not going to allow it. Government, of course, another example I can give is that over the years in our community, Health Canada were doing sampling of water in our community and whatnot. But they weren't informing us that the levels of uranium, natural uranium in our water, were dangerous. Nobody informed. It was kind of all, but lots of research. At one point, they do human sampling. They do a handful of people, but that information is not really flowing. And when it is, it's just bits and pieces. We're not scientists, so we can't figure out everything. We don't have the resources all the time to review it. Only to find out about 14 years ago that indeed that the levels of uranium in our water were dangerous and that we had to stop consuming the water, so that today we have, there's been some changes, mind you, but still drinking bottled water in plastic jugs, and that's a story of its own, the plastics and whatnot. But to show again how research was not used to help the community, but rather there was fear that there would have to be too large of an investment. And let me add another piece to that. We knew, we had read about the radon gas issue and how Health Canada had determined what the level is going to be. And I'm not a scientist again, we're looking, it's what's called 800 becquerels. While elsewhere in the world, France, Germany, the US, it was about 150 becquerels, so much lower. And eventually Health Canada reduced it to 200. And there had been a few studies sampling in the community, and they had found that several homes had really, really high levels of radon gas being emitted in the home. And they said, we're letting you know you have very high levels of radon gas, not explaining in any way what the implications might be. And keeping in mind that you may have a smoker in the house and how radon gas really attaches itself to the dust particles, attaches themselves to your lung, you may or may not get cancer, but you have a higher level. And when we attempted to go back to this government department to say, well, shouldn't we sample the whole community? Shouldn't we find out? They said, no, don't worry. We've done a bit of sampling. So we had decided at the time, no, we're going to find the resources. We're going to find our own people that are going to give us the data, and we'll determine how to use that data. And what we found was that there were 200 homes where the levels of radon gas were unacceptable, and we had to do something. There had to be mitigation measures. It took a lot of push on government to get the resources to make it happen. But again, all of that to say how it was being held against us out of a fear that maybe more resources would need to be put in, or we would not need to understand. And finally, because I could go on and on about these health issues, I recall after they had done the water sampling and the Health Canada scientists had come to the community and they were on this long table in our gymnasium. And the community members asked, should we be worried when we take a shower? Not the consumption of it, but should we be worried that this uranium in the water could impact our health? Should we be worried when we bathe our babies whose skin is different than an adult? That end of the table said, don't have to worry, not an issue. The molecules cannot enter into the skin and into your body, don't worry. The scientists at that end of the table said, well, we're not sure. So there we were as a community, totally confused. And a community member then asked, would you like to drink our community water then, if you're saying it's so safe? And no, we can't. And again, it was a lack of respect. It was a lack of protocol. It was a lack of, you know, we're gonna do it in a good way to help the community, to benefit the community. They were more worried about themselves. They were also busy trying to write scientific journal articles that were gonna benefit their own promotions not worrying about the people and the children and everyone else in the community that were consuming this water. And again, examples from the past, really negative examples. So it makes it difficult now as we move into the present and try to think about the future of how we're going to approach it. And I think for most community, we do it reluctantly, but we're hoping that these kind of institutes and other things that go on, there'll be a better understanding of what needs to be done. And again, it begins by respect, it begins by understanding, it begins by talking to people, it begins by trying to understand the community. But damn it, being honest with the community, with facts. You know, as we say, we're ready to reach out and, you know, to the hand and work with people, but, you know, this whole thing, if I ask you to put your hand in the stove and you get burned the first time, if I ask you to do it a second time, will you trust me if I tell you it's, no, the stove is cold? Well, you might say, I'll give you a second chance, but the third time, mm-hmm. you're going to say, you put your hand first, and then I'll put mine. That kind of thing. So that for me is the past. A lot of hurt and pain that has come. A lot of mistrust, you know. But from that, what I've learned, it's taken me a while to learn, are we able to move beyond this? Well, of course we can. There's an opportunity, a tremendous opportunity. But it's important, very, very important that it's not only, again, having been in those leadership positions, it's so important that it not only be the leadership or small groups of people in the community, but as many people as possible are aware of what's going on in these kind, if there is research in the community. And that's not easy. It's easily said. We talk of community. Well, let's go talk to the community. Well, our community has 3,000 people. You're not going to talk to 3,000 people. Not going to happen that way. But as many people as possible being informed, I think is an important step. Miigwech.
We're concerned about research. You've talked about health, and in Lac-Saint-Anne there was a research done in the 40s by the Federal Department of Indian Affairs, Department of Health, and the Provincial Department of Health, testing a rare blood that existed. And we were completely unaware of the fact that that research had been done, and studies had been presented at an international blood conference in Paris in 1950. We have a lot of things that we've been our people have been discovering about research done on us, but we've only been discovering that since the really starting in about the late 60s, late 50s in some places in the 60s, and since then, of course, and research that has been done by people about the Métis people and Métis history and so on, that have really left such a great misunderstanding about the Métis people, starting with all of the studies, PhD thesis and so on, about the origins of the Métis people, all starting around Red River, and there being a mass diaspora from there, and that's the Métis people in Canada, which is nonsense, completely complete and absolute nonsense. And so we're finding out about these things that have been done in terms of research on us, and our concern about the research of the past is how much we have to either fill in the voids, because there's unwritten chapters of history about the Métis people, or start doing our own work to correct the kinds of misconceptions. Also, we're discovering research in the past that has been used by governments without our knowledge to deny not only the rights of the Métis people, but the very existence of the Métis people. And on the second question, I want to talk more about the Pauli case in Sault Ste. Marie. But I just want to mention one research report that was done in 1885. By a man by the name of Boron, who was appointed by the government of Ontario because they were very concerned that the payouts, the annual annuities, payouts for for the members of the people who were part of the Robinson treaties, Robinson Huron, Robinson Superior treaty. Government was saying, what's going on here? We have to pay out more and more every year. The numbers should be going down because we're enfranchising them, or their health isn't that good. So why is it we're paying more and more every year? So Boron's report at the end of it, he had quite a very thick report. There's just one paragraph that sums up everything. He said, I'm paraphrasing, had Mr. Robinson known of the fecundity and longevity of the French half-breeds, surely he would never have allowed them to be part of the treaty. So they were all struck from the rolls. We've had all kinds of people who have been struck from the rolls, and we're now starting to find out these various reports that have been done in the by the federal government, striking people from the rolls in the numbered treaties. So research that's been done in the past by governments and forming the basis on which they deny our rights and our existence is something that is a concern to us in terms of on that score.
The concern for research in the Arctic and particularly with Inuit, with the increasing interest in the Arctic, and there wasn't always interest in the Arctic, I suppose, but there became a real interest in the Arctic in terms of economic development, resource extraction, issues of sovereignty, seabed mapping, climate change really brought a huge, huge influx of interest in the Arctic. And of course with it came the research and the need for more understanding of processes and in the Arctic. And with that came more opportunities and a more push for Inuit to become involved in research programs that that addressed Arctic and Inuit issues. Early on, thinking that with the concern in the 60s and 70s over contaminants, airborne and waterborne and so forth, you know, people thought that the Arctic is pristine. It'd be the best benchmark of which to compare other parts of the globe in terms of contaminants, until someone did some research and found actually there were high amounts of contaminants in soil and water in the Arctic, and they started to wonder what's going on here. So Inuit have had long-standing research relationships with certain programs, like the Northern Contaminants Program, First Nations and Inuit Health Branch research in health. Other programs started coming around, like Arctic Net, which was looking at climate change in the north, and then, you know, even more recently, the Canadian High Arctic Research Station, which the past government wanted to establish in the Arctic. And so it meant Inuit pushed and mobilized to become part of those programs to help guide and to try to have more say in how those research programs were unfolding. Sat on many research management committees for those organizations and programs, argued for board membership, pushed for better regional representation on those research management committees. So over the years, it's been a slow but developing relationship, I suppose you would say. And incremental more involvement, responsibility for Inuit in research programs in the Arctic. But withstanding that, there are still many examples of where we just haven't quite reached the mark. And some on the panel have already articulated certain examples. In the Arctic, there's the ever widening gap between southern wildlife biologists, particularly as one example, polar bear biologists, and Inuit elders and hunters, who have just very different perspectives on the plight of polar bear and to what degree they are endangered or not endangered. Great differences of opinion, which come about because of the processes and the way things get done and the research gets done. Inuit being in the Arctic and hunting and observing over great every season, over time, weekly, monthly, daily, etc., versus researchers are coming up during certain seasons or focusing on certain seasons and as snapshots. And this has led to very differing opinions of the results of the research. Politically as well, I'll use the example of the Canadian Higher Arctic Research Station, where Inuit were developing very good relationships with the staff in rolling out the program, and were involved in rolling out the program. Only to find that not long ago, under the past government, that a very important Inuit research priority, which was Inuit health and wellness, was struck from the priority list at the highest order of government. And so Inuit had no say or recourse except to, you know, send letters to ministers and the normal recourse. But just very surprising events that Inuit get left with in terms of research and other examples for very good reason. A number of researchers met in Thunder Bay at a meeting to try to incite and force more interest in the past government of research and using the best available knowledge for decision making and policy making and so forth. And this group wrote an Arctic research manifesto. They called it a manifesto. And unfortunately, this group forgot to include or did not include Inuit in any of the deliberations. And so when Inuit look and read the manifesto, there are many things that Inuit would have adjusted and some things they would have added, and so Inuit had to come out again and say, well, that manifesto doesn't necessarily represent Inuit perspectives in terms of Arctic research. It was done for good reason, but as was stated, individuals were speaking on behalf of Inuit, and in terms of the past, Inuit have mobilized themselves more and more through the establishment of Inuit Khayisarving at the Inuit Knowledge Center to bring together regional representatives into a national organization or a national representative committee that can start discussing these incidences and start influencing the way research happens. And I'll leave it there so I can talk about more of the present in the future in the next questions.
Obviously, we could tie in question 2 and 3 together in terms of present and future, and the Indigenous communities have an interest towards self-determination, both as. And that means also as individuals, but as communities as well. And that's certainly something I believe it's for communities and researchers to consider. But I offer you an opportunity to do one round of closing remarks, if at all you desire to incorporate any of the questions that we've talked about or elaborate on anything you've made, Geneviève. Thank you for today.
CIHR developed some guidelines, and why there were no guidelines at the time, it was because we had a tri-council policy statement in 1998, but there was no chapter on Aboriginal research because Aboriginal communities had not been consulted. So that's why there was a policy gap to be filled, and the scientific director of CIHR took the lead, developed some guidelines, ensured consultation with communities from the very beginning and several times, not just token gesture, but throughout the development of the guidelines. And these guidelines were incorporated in 2010 into the Tri-Council Policy Statement. I remember Scott, we were there. It was a little painful at the time, but they ended up being incorporated into what we now have as the Tri-Council Policy Statement and Chapter 9. I just want to say that what's important in Chapter 9, there are a number of principles, 19 or 20. What is really important is the community engagement. The Tri-Council Policy Statement, Chapter 9, gives examples of how can the community be consulted. It's important to recognize, as has been said before, the diversity of Aboriginal communities. How do you engage communities? That's the key element. Who are these authority structures you need to speak with? What are the protocols? What questions you need to ask, but more importantly, what you need to learn. And that's the approach to start building that relationship with communities from the beginning, taking the time, not watching how long it's going to take you, just establish that relationship. So it's acknowledged in Chapter 9. And what is essential as well is that it's important to have a participatory research approach, which I don't know if any of you is familiar with that expression. It means that people involved in the research who are going to, we hope, benefit from the research are going to be involved from the very beginning, from the get-go, in terms of the research design. Who's going to be collecting the data, analyzing the data? Who's going to be benefiting from research? Is it going to be is it going to be research results, or does it go beyond? And that's what's in Chapter 9 as well, and that's why it's so strong. It goes as far as talking about the need to train this, try to provide some support for training, for building capacity, research capacity, for hiring local people as well, involve them in the conduct of research. And a very important element as well is the dissemination of research results. And we talked about this from the beginning. Very often it didn't take place. So how does that actually take place? So it's important to have in the engagement plan that element really being addressed from the beginning. How is the dissemination of the research results going to take place? And the importance of communities looking at these results and making sure these contextual elements are being taken care of, and not that they have the final say, but they have a very important say. In terms of how it's going to be published, and then the intellectual property aspect as well. And so all these aspects in Chapter 9, I want to also draw your attention to the importance of developing research agreements. And I say this because I've been sitting on research ethics boards for several years, and I've seen these projects come to us for researchers wanting to work with Aboriginal communities. And you know what? These research agreements were there. But they were either they were not signed. So actually, and it raises an important question that maybe has not dealt with until now, is who in a research institution is going to be signing the research agreement? Is it just a researcher? What weight does it have? What are his responsibilities? So, and all these sensitive issues, normal issues that need to be addressed, privacy, confidentiality, or co-ownership, or ownership or intellectual property by communities. And we talked about the other codes of conduct, and the OCAP principles are entrenched, actually encouraged for First Nations in the Chapter 9. And there are also the licensing requirements, of course, in the North. But it's a very important to have make sure that in research agreements, they are suggested in Chapter 9, but it's very important that they be there to explain, describe mutual responsibilities, and that Aboriginal communities make sure it's in these research agreements, signed, properly signed, so that they actually have a way of following up if something goes doesn't go right afterwards. So and I've seen as well on the REB, project that had commercial purposes, and again these issues were not discussed in the research agreement. So it's essential. And my last word is on the need for researchers to be humble, as I said, to take the time, respect, listen, and then they start asking questions. And I want to refer to a recent workshop that took place in Wendake in Quebec City on DNA on loan. Referring to biological samples, anyway, and all the abuse that took place in the past, and the tension regarding access to data, research data right now, and administrative data, and health data. And so you may have heard of that explosion of, you know, big data. Everybody wants to have the data. In Canada, they're developing partnership with an international, you know, organization to be accessed, to be able to use this data. So I think this is something that's should really be kept on the radar in terms of how our Aboriginal community is going to be able to protect their data, not just that it's going to be used not for treatment, but for other purposes. So I think that's where I see the very important challenge that needs to be discussed, and TCPS probably needs to be stronger and more demanding regarding that important challenge.
Self-determination is not what we have now, for sure. It's not how things have been working for the past over 150 years, certainly in the relationship we've had. There has to be a major shift. I mean, it's unfortunate that, having been around long enough, hearing this in the early 70s, that we were at a juncture in our time that this shift was going to happen. And throughout the 70s, I heard it, throughout the 80s, throughout the 90s, now we're in 2000, we're beyond that, we're at this juncture that things are going to happen, you know, and we continue to hope that it will, but and understanding that, certainly from my perspective, is that research is an important component of that self-determination that we've always had, but is trying to articulate it in the daily activities of what we do. And I encourage you, in whatever work you're going to do, do not ever come and appropriate who we are, our identity, our culture, our ceremonies. They are too sacred to us. Respect them, support them, understand them, maybe even live by them, by the teachings that will come. But don't begin to do research on them so that you can come back to university and kind of impress people. They belong to us. Too much has already been taken. But our self-determination, I don't believe that I will see it in my lifetime, the kind of self-determination that our elders speak about, the kind of reconnection and respect that we justly deserve. But I am hoping that our young people that are on the path that they are, and we're seeing a lot of our young people that have sought balance from the academic and learning, but also of who they are and that reconnection. Not all, but many that I meet, I get the chance to speak with, I just sit back in awe and say, wow. And they're strong and they're filled with that strength that carries out in a good way. I'm an angry person, I'm fed up with things, but the young people are balanced and bring that. And I encourage them to do that. And I view my role now to support them and encourage them to be that voice, so that indeed we're not moving, we're not doing the cha-cha sideways, backwards, but we're doing a forward dance, the dance of our people around the circle of wholeness and connection. So, miigwech.
At the outset, I forgot to mention that, yes, my name is Tony Belcourt, and so I have my own history, but I'm proud to say that I'm Christy Belcourt's dad. If you don't know about Christy, then Google her. She is one of Canada's foremost Aboriginal artists, having been received many acknowledgments. The first, the Governor General's first award given this year, inaugurational awards. There were six people given awards for innovation. Five of them were all science and technology, and Christy was in art. It's because she's taking our traditions and our values that are embodied in our art. The Métis people are known as the flower beadwork people. Our knowledge, our Indigenous way of knowing is embedded in our storytelling as oral peoples. That's where our knowledge is embedded, and it also manifests itself in things that we cover ourselves with or that we make. Christy's lifelong work now has been to express a lot of this knowledge through art and to teach and to try to have people understand and respect the land and all the land that gives us and the waters and the importance of land and water to life for all things, and not the least of which are human beings. She teaches through traditional medicines. The Cancer Society in Ontario had commissioned her to do a mural of traditional medicines that have been used in the treating of cancers and other kinds of awful things in terms of health. When people are thinking of doing research about the Métis people, other Aboriginal peoples as well, I think it's important to think about where you're getting your information from. Who are the people that you're talking to that are the authorities that really know? Seek out the people that really know. I often have seen researchers go to talk to paid employees at organizations. Well, paid employees at organizations have a responsibility and they have a certain amount of knowledge, but you're never going to find a Maria Campbell working in a Métis association somewhere. You're never going to find a Christy Belcourt working in an association. These are our people who are bringing a lot of lost knowledge, or knowledge that is not commonly understood even within our communities, because we've been, what's happened to us by governments that have stolen our land. The whole question of the issue of the Indian residential school system, the loss of our language, traditions and knowledge because of dispossession. Dispossession of land and dispossession of way of life. A lot has been lost, but not all of it has been lost, as I said, because of our knowledge keepers, those people who have that kind of knowledge. And I'm proud to say my daughter is one of them. She's gained it. She's gained it in ceremony. I too have gained a lot of knowledge in ceremony. We had a nation-to-nation relationship with the Anishinaabeg Nation at one time based on traditional ways to restore traditional relationships that existed for 150 years in the case of the Anishinaabeg Nation of Ontario and our people in Western Canada. So a lot of things that are on the shelf about Métis people, that the research that's been done, and so on. Well, first of all, in Ontario, I know that there isn't very much around here, because the Ontario government's position was that the Métis were, they disappeared when with the hanging of Louis Riel on November 16, 1885. And we have a lot of knowledge that's now vested in places like the Gabriel Dumont Institute, which is run by Métis people that are seeking out our knowledge keepers and having them write books and produce publications for various ages. And also people who are we now have CDs on the Michif language and so on. We have these knowledge keepers. People are going to do research. The political organizations, I'll call them, certainly have a role and a responsibility. But they're not the only source. When you're going to be validate what it is you're being told. A lot of people don't do that. A lot of people are writing things. There's all kinds of mythology that exists now because people have just come up with some stuff and written a book about it. And it's terrible. We have a lot of work to do, and we're scrambling, Métis people, trying to undo a lot of the misinformation, misconceptions that are out there. But thankfully, we have our own people now that are starting to do it. I echo what Chief Whiteduck has said, that we have young people now that are coming along. They too are going to university and colleges where people of my age weren't there. And they're starting to bring their knowledge in an academic sense as well. Thankfully for that. So I'm grateful. I want to say I'm grateful very much to the organizers for inviting me to participate on this panel. It's enriching to me personally to have my eyes opened about this whole area of ethics and research on Indigenous peoples. I'm glad to see it's there. I obviously feel that there needs to be some adjustments to Chapter 9, and I'll be urging that in the future.
Without a doubt, my Nathan Obed, the president of our organization, who's out there advocating on behalf of Inuit all the time, has continually said that information is important. It's very important for Inuit. It's important for him to be able to advocate on behalf of the people he represents. The problem he always articulates is that often there's not enough information, Inuit-specific information, for him to do a good job or to articulate what needs to happen with these huge gaps that exist out there in all sorts of areas, from health to environment to a number of issues. Or a lot of information exists, but it's information that is not necessarily useful for his advocacy. And it's not information that Inuit want to gather and want to have gathered to serve their purposes so that they can move forward with their own advocacy. So, without a doubt, the information is important to have, and we need to move forward and get those. And Inuit need to have the opportunities to articulate their priorities and to be engaged and involved enough to move that forward and have the responsibility, be in positions of responsibility to be able to do that and to broker their own relationship, so it's not someone else speaking on their behalf. And I think we're hearing that over and over. And it's a challenge to move those ideals forward. But it's, I suppose it's happening, and it's happening with our you know, with Inuit youth, Indigenous youth, and the relationships that they're brokering with the new guard that's coming up from southern institutions and academic institutions. And the more Inuit we have in these institutions, the more the exchanges occur. And so I suppose there's hope for those of us that might be cynical over the last number of decades. I would say to be wary of the new open data movement, which is, I suppose, needed and of good intention, so that academic researchers aren't squirreling away data in shoeboxes in their office somewhere, that it's actually out there and people can get access. And Inuit want access to a lot of information that is out there, and there should be ways that Inuit can get access to that. And that can't happen if it's squirreled away in a shoebox in someone's office. But at the same time, one has to be wary that the open data movement can also become another tool of colonialism, and one has to be very wary of that. Inuit, in gathering their own community-based research, have some information that they don't want to share, and that is proprietary to individuals and to communities. And so there's a lot of things to work out in this area of the open data movement. But it's there and it's coming, and governments are signing on, and so I just highlight because it's something that we're finding we're having to deal with currently, right now. For Inuit, I would say that to move forward, we need to improve academic research ethics board in the way they function. The research ethics boards do their best, and it's a really tough job. If you ever get into the position of being on a research ethics board, you'll find that it's a very, very tough job, and everybody's doing their best. But without having the expertise, the Indigenous expertise at the table, the results that come out often are not what Inuit would hope for in many cases. And this leads Inuit to think of forming an Inuit research ethics board, or finding new ways that Inuit can be in control of those kind of decisions and those kind of ethics, and in control of information, and having possession and ownership of their own data, and access to data that is gathered by others. And these are things that Inuit are moving forward in a big way, and taking this seriously. One last thing I'll leave you is also the issue of benefits accruing to Indigenous peoples, to Inuit, and remaining for Inuit in the Arctic. That we have a long way to go, but we're having discussions about having institutions, a university in the Arctic, so that Inuit can enjoy research or gathering information without having to leave the North, to come down, to sever family ties and so forth. So those discussions are happening and hold great promise for the future. And I suppose for moving forward, just, you know, we all have to think about finding ways to combat colonialism in research, and finding other ways to promote reconciliation in research as well. And I guess we all have that responsibility, all of us here. So I guess I'll leave it there. And thank you very much. I really enjoyed being on the panel.
Thanks very much, everybody. We hope I hope they'll be available for us throughout the lunch hour and the week. And thank you. I hope you enjoyed the panel.